Good evening, everyone. Good evening, everyone. My name is Margaret Brownlee. I'm an academic advisor on the USM Gorham campus. I advise roughly over 300 students navigating everything from online course selection, early career planning, and proactive study skills. I recognize a bunch of students here in the office, here in the audience, and that makes me really excited to see them. I also co-facilitate the Gorham Diversity Awareness Meetings and the FIG on Intercultural Diversity. Tonight, I would like to welcome you to the annual event, Becoming American, W.E.B. DuBois, and the Meaning of Race and Citizenship in the Jim Crow Era. This evening's program will focus on W.E.B. DuBois' seminal work, The Souls of Black Folk, as a guide to explore African-American quest for citizenship, equality, and justice through history, poetry, and music. It is a pleasure to have you all here tonight, and we are grateful for your continued support of our programming here at USM. Lastly, I would like to request that all of our speakers tonight proceed according to the program, and ask that each individual come to the side of the stage as soon as the person before them is finished. Thank you in advance. Without much to do, I would like to introduce our next speaker, USM Provost Janine Uzi.
Welcome. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to USM, and I can just feel the excitement in the room, which I share. Anytime I'm given the mic, I like to do just a little tiny bit of bragging about our faculty. Our faculty do some incredible work, not only at USM, but in the state and beyond. So I want to say just a little bit about the two faculty members who organized this event tonight. I won't say too much because the dean of the college is coming up here next and he'll give you some more detail. But tonight you will hear from Professor Leroy Rowe, who is our Assistant Professor of African American History and Politics. He's also co-chair of the President's Committee on Inclusivity and Diversity. Professor Rowe has a BS from Lincoln University of Missouri, and he has his master's and PhD from the University of Missouri. And I think the dean will say a little bit more about his latest book project, which we're all waiting to read. Professor Nicholas Dossman is our second faculty member, who is assistant professor and director of choral studies at USM. And tonight he will lead these fine students in a number of gospel pieces and sorrow songs. Professor Dossman has a BM from Oberlin. He has an MME from Florida State University and an EDD from Columbia. His most recent publication is called Why Music Matters in Urban School Districts. And so I think there's a particular pointedness to that article here. Finally, it's my pleasure to give a special welcome to a group of students who are here from Portland area high schools. Not just the Portland public schools, but from a number of high schools in the area. And these students, who are the future leaders for all of us, are known as the King Fellows. So I want to say a little bit about the King Fellows, and then I'm going to introduce them to you and also just say a little thank you to the people who are leading this effort. So the King Fellows is a program developed by Rachel Talbot Ross. Rachel, where are you? Can you stand up, please? Yes! She's defying the provost. Rachel Talbot Ross is probably someone who needs no introduction, but I will just say a little bit about her anyway. Many of you know that she served as Portland's Multicultural Affairs Director and that she's now running for House District 40 in Portland. She is the brains really behind the King Fellows program, and she has been bringing together leaders from the area, from Portland Public Schools, from USM, to create out of this grassroots kind of initiative something that's sustainable, that will sustain these students and help them meet their aspirations to take the world to new places. So we really thank her. I'd also like to acknowledge Marina Blanchard, and I can't see yet. Marina, where are you? There she is. No one person can do what Rachel does, so we are putting together a team of people who can try to approximate that. So Marina is helping us take over some responsibility for the King Fellows program. Along with her, I want to acknowledge Mariana Cruz, who is our new Assistant Dean of Students for Diversity and Inclusion at USM, and she will also be supporting the King Fellows program for a number of hours a week. And I'm just going to give you her credentials too, because it's so impressive. She has a BA from the University of Puerto Rico, an MA from Texas Women's University, an MS from Cornell University, and she's currently pursuing her PhD at Cornell. So Mariana, where are you? There she is. Thank you. I'd like to give you just a little bit of a larger context for this event tonight. And that's increased attention to inclusivity, to the inclusivity of the USM community. This summer and fall, we hosted day-long training events at USM on community inclusion. We have a new training that we offer and actually require for all search committees that deals with issues of implicit bias and also helps search committees conduct the most inclusive searches possible. Mariana's position is one piece of this puzzle through which we are hoping to do a much better job being the most welcoming community we can be. And finally, Professor Rowe, whom you'll hear from later, has helped a team of faculty design a new minor at USM on race and ethnic studies that we rolled out this very fall. So there's a lot. Thank you. So this program happens in a much larger context of a conversation that's happening at USM about how we can open our doors even wider to the community and make every student, every faculty member, every staff member feel as welcome as possible. And so before I turn the mic over to Adam, I would like to ask all the King Fellows, whom we hope to, who will all be students at USM one day, to stand, and we will honor you and thank you for being here. I think you all have a lot to teach us. So thank you again for being here. I hope you enjoy the events, and I'm looking forward to getting to talk with many of you after the festivities are over. So thank you again, and good luck all.
Many welcomes tonight. I too would like to welcome everyone to USM and say at the outset here today, as the dean of the college that includes the School of Music and the Department of History and Political Science, that I take tremendous institutional pride in this event today, which promises, I think, to be extraordinarily unique. But before we do that, I'd like to thank a few people who haven't been mentioned so far today. First of all, I'd like to thank Nikki Leclerc, who is a staff member in the Department of History and Political Science. There you are. Putting an event on like this, there are tremendous logistical challenges, and actually having so many people here is a great credit both to the faculty and to the staff at USM. We'd also like to thank our good friends at the Maine Humanities Council, which is funding tonight's event. And with Maine Humanities Council's endorsement, we were able to go to the Warren Memorial Foundation for more funding so we can take this event on the road to Westbrook and Lewiston in February during Black History Month. So we're very excited to be able to do that and tell your friends. Furthermore, I'd also like to announce that the Department of Philosophy on November 10th at 2:45 is going to convene a symposium on Du Bois on the seventh floor of Glickman Library, and it'd be wonderful if many of you could turn out to that event as well. To close, when Professor Rowe was discussing his aims for this event, he called himself an activist, but he believed that his role as an activist was to explain or question and probe the historical and cultural context to explain why things are. Last year and this year have demonstrated anything at all, I think. It has demonstrated the need for extensive humanistic and civic education. Martin Luther King, paraphrasing a New England transcendentalist, a white New England transcendentalist, once said that the arc of the universe is long, but it bends toward justice. But as an historian, W.E.B. Du Bois was not so sure. In 1857, writing for the majority in the infamous Dred Scott case, Roger Taney insisted that slaves and the descendants of slaves were beings of, quote, an inferior order and could not become American citizens, and that they had, quote, no rights that a white person is bound to respect. That's the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. 10 years later, however, after a momentous civil war, Taney's decision was overturned in the majesty of the 14th Amendment, which this event celebrates here today. Hopefully all of you will leave as not Second Amendment people, but 14th Amendment people. The 14th Amendment read that all persons born or naturalized in the United States are U.S. citizens, and that all U.S. citizens have a right to the equal protection of the law. Just 10 years after the Dred Scott decision. But then what happened? What happened in the 1870s or the 1890s or 1920s or in the 1960s? Du Bois taught us that history does not move in a single direction. As he put it in his magisterial work of his own, Reconstruction, the slave went free, stood for a brief moment in the sun, and then moved back into slavery. Professor Rowe and Professor Dossman will teach us about what happened in the aftermath of emancipation here tonight. And I'm so grateful that so many of you are here today to learn more about it. So thank you for coming.
On behalf of the Department of History and Political Science, I'd like to welcome you. It is an honor to co-sponsor this event. It reflects the interdisciplinary synergy of our department's majors and our new interdisciplinary minor in race and ethnic studies. Welcome.
Good evening. My name is Alan Kashub. I'm the director of the USM School of Music, and I am so happy to see you all here tonight. This is a real privilege for us in the School of Music to join with our colleagues in the History Department to present this to you. I think if I were going to sum up this year for us in the School of Music, this is the year of collaboration. We are undertaking a huge project with art and theater that will last all year and be presented in the spring. And I think our students, our faculty, and all of us are privileged and learn so much when we get outside our walls and work together. And I'm just so pleased that we could lend our voices to this wonderful event. So thank you and enjoy.
Hello. My name is Brooke, and I'm here to do an introduction of W.E.B. Du Bois and who he was, his influence on Black culture in America. William Edward Burghardt, also known widely as W.E.B. DuBois, was one of the most influential black activists of the early 20th century. His academic achievement, despite racial adversity, served as an inspiration to a population freshly escaped from the bonds of slavery. He earned a bachelor's degree from Fisk University, and then he later moved on to Harvard University to receive his PhD. Du Bois did this despite facing immense discrimination from his professors and colleagues at both schools. Two of his works, which he later went on to publish when he was working at the Atlanta University, in 1899 he published The Philadelphia Negro, which was the first case study to study, it was the first case study to analyze racism being one of the main causes of poverty and disparity in the black community. His groundbreaking work was one of the first of its kind, and it's the first to directly acknowledge that race relations are the cause of, or were the cause of human suffering in a post-slave society. Du Bois published another book called The Souls of Black Folk, which he gathered poetry, historical content, and memoirs, establishing a diverse picture of the black American experience. This image was celebratory in nature, unlike many documents depicting black Americans at the time. Du Bois directly, Du Bois believed firmly that protest and legal citizen-based rights were the answer to, were the answer to solving the black community's problems. In 1911, Du Bois was appointed editor of the NAACP's new magazine, The Crisis. For the following 20 years, Du Bois would devote himself to using this platform to address serious adversity in the black community, such as poverty, lynching, and violence towards black people. Du Bois was also a major advocate for Pan-Africanism, and Du Bois was also a well-known advocate, I'm a little bit nervous. I don't... he advocated for Pan-Africanism. He sincerely believed that with the power of the pen, the power of organizing, black people would be able to transform the world for the better, not only in regards with activism and human rights, but democracy as a whole. Ultimately, it was Du Bois's research and radical nature that transformed the black transformed black empowerment in America. It was his celebration of blackness, as it was for and what it could be, that would serve as a model for black activists in the mid-20th century. He was not only an inspiration, but an innovator of black modern black American thought and empowerment. So, thank you.
Well, the main theme was song in November 1990. I think what we tried to do there is to sneak something in on you. We wanted to let you know that DuBois was here. We wanted to see how many people would have jumped out of their seats, actually. And so, to an extent, I wanted you to hear DuBois' own words. And I wasn't sure if it's coming across loudly enough. And I wonder if you could please replay that just for a moment. Because I think DuBois really does puts us into that context about what he envisioned for his own work, as well as his own ideals and philosophy about blackness and the way in which African Americans were treated in America. So please rewind that one for me.
In that time, I think I made the people of the United States, and especially the colored people, realize just what the legal problem was and what they had got to solve it. I was pretty radical in some things I said. I made a good many enemies, but on the other hand, the magazine became self-supporting. It didn't cost the Associated anything. The magazine paid my salary and the expenses of publication. So for 20 years, publicity was no expense to the NAACP. And on the other hand, I had very wide freedom in saying just what I wanted to say. I was looking over some copies the other day and came across an incident where a prominent man who was trustee of Harvard College wrote to cancel his subscription. That was in 1925. He said that to his horror when he was in London in 1924. He found that we were beating the Strand with placards concerning minting in the United States, and he thought that was a very bad way of washing the dirt in our own country in a foreign land. And I read it in written the reply I made. I was going to wash that linen anywhere that I got soap and water, and while I was sorry to lose his support, nevertheless, that's the sort of thing that we were going to do, not the kind of talk I was going to endorse. Well, of course, that was smart, but nevertheless, it didn't help the NAACP with a certain class of people in the United States.
Simon the Cyrenian speaks
by
County Cullen. He never spoke a word to me, and yet he called my name. He never gave a sign to me, and yet I knew and came. At first I said, I will not bear his cross upon my back. He only seeks to place it there because my skin is black. But he was dying for a dream, and he was very meek. And in his eyes there shone a gleam, men journey far to seek. It was himself my pity bought, that I for Christ alone would all of Rome would not have wrought with bruise of lash or stone.
Good evening. I am Glenn Cummings. I'm the president here and at the University of Southern Maine. And I really know that you're ready for these amazing speeches and discussions and dialogue, so I won't get in your way. I most importantly want to say thank you. I want to say thank you to Dr. Rowe, thank you to Dr. Dossman, and the leadership that is taken to bring this together. A great university wrestles with great issues, and I am delighted that tonight we get to come together and wrestle with really great pertinent issues. Issues of history and issues of the present and unambiguously the hope of the future. I'm delighted to be here. I wish you a wonderful night. Thank you all for the work that you put in for being here. Thank you.
Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. The text of a Negro spiritual. As we know, Africans were brought to the Americas, and they had their own religion, their own culture prior to coming here. This genre, the Negro spiritual, developed as a result of African descendants being Christianized later in history. This text, Swing Low, Sweet Chariot, embodies the struggles and the sorrow that these descendants of slaves had experienced.
Thank you.
That was amazing. Give another round, please. I can tell I have my work cut out for me. How do you follow that? Again, I want to thank you all for being here and for giving me the opportunity to talk a little bit about the experiences of African Americans in this country. The mistreatment of African Americans or Black Americans reveal a long and deplorable chapter in this country's history. The struggle of enslaved, disenfranchised, and oppressed Black folk to become Americans. And by that I mean to be fully liberated and accepted equally as citizens who enjoy the rights and rewards that a democratic society provides has been an ongoing struggle, a battle. From the very first slave ships that brought approximately 700,000 kidnapped Africans to North America, to the nearly 1 million Black men, women, boys, and girls who are currently incarcerated in American prisons and jails, Black people have engaged in a sustained struggle for freedom and justice. At the same time, what it means to be American has always been defined and understood to a great extent along racially constructed lines that excluded and marginalized African Americans and other people of color. Now, the first group of Africans that arrived in this country in what is now the United States in 1619 were not all slaves. In fact, many went on to own property, paid taxes, voted, married legally. Some were sued by white folk, and others sued white folks. In fact, some historians argue that they actually became Englishmen. But by the end of the 17th century, a series of slave codes had codified into law the system of racial slavery, whereby bondage became permanently linked to blackness, and on the other hand, liberty was reserved exclusively for Europeans. This is known as the American paradox. Indeed, enslaved people were considered chattel without rights to their person or legal protection from sexual violations, cruel punishments, and the separation of parent and children. Historian Wilma King called the enslavement of African American children stolen childhood. But the institution of slavery didn't just rob enslaved children of a childhood. It also denied them a humanity. Slave owners achieved this by preventing enslaved children from bearing the names of their fathers and from knowing their exact date of birth. And yet, the spirit of African Americans could not be broken. That hunger for freedom, the most basic of human instincts, manifested itself in the form of slave revolts, such as Nate Turner's Rebellion of 1831, as well as the actions of runaway slaves, Frederick Douglass, Harriet Tubman, and many more who sought freedom on the Underground Railroad. That same Harriet Tubman that soon will be on the $20 bill. For some reason, she'll be still supervised by Andrew Jackson. But I think eventually he'll be kicked to the curb eventually. The idea of liberty for free people of color, you see, not all African Americans were actually enslaved. There were hundreds of thousands of free black people or people of color in this country. And they coexisted in America at a time when they had mothers, fathers, brothers, sisters, and cousins that were held in bondage. Now, on the one hand, they were free. But imagine the terror of every night going to bed knowing that you don't know where your relations are, what's happening to them. The essence of liberty could only be achieved once you eliminate the inhuman system of slavery, once and for all. That remained an unyielding goal of all African Americans, that one day to see the destruction of the institution of racial slavery in America. As the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 demonstrated, a slave owner could call upon the resources of the national government and actually force state governments and local authorities to hand over runaway slaves and return them back to their owners. Indeed, it was not uncommon for freed people of color, even those who had never been enslaved in their lives, to be subjected to kidnappings, where they were often sold into the Deep South, into slavery. You have watched 12 Years a Slave. Some of you have read the manuscript. While on the other hand, slave owners had the rights of citizenship in this country, the Missouri slaves, Harriet and Dred Scott, learned when they filed freedom suits in the courts that they had none. As Dean Tuchinsky alluded to earlier, in Dred Scott v. Sanford, 1857, the U.S. Supreme Court, the highest judicial body in this country, ruled that slaves were not citizens, and as a consequence, could not bring suits in federal courts. Furthermore, the court went on to add that because black people were not and could never be citizens of this country, they therefore had no rights that the white man was bound to respect. It is within this context that within a few short years, we would have a civil war in this country that would be waged over the issue of slavery. Whether this peculiar institution in human bondage would be allowed to expand further west, or whether we will do away with it. It is this war that finally resulted in the abolition of slavery and the promise of citizenship for former slaves. President Abraham Lincoln issued the Emancipation Proclamation, which provided that slaves still in the rebellious southern states would be freed on January 1st, 1863. Now keep in mind that this was a wartime measure meant to shore up support at home for the Union. It excluded enslaved peoples in territories under Union military control, as well as it excluded those in the border states of Missouri, Kentucky, Maryland, and others that was not in rebellion. What I'm trying to suggest is that emancipation was a process, a long process, an ongoing process. It was not an event. Technically, the complete abolition of slavery did not occur until the 13th Amendment was passed by Congress and then ratified by the states. That occurred in 1865. The former slaves hoped emancipation would bring true freedom from all forms of bondage, and importantly, justice, which from their perspective meant each person would be treated equally, that they would have the right finally to exercise control over their persons, as well as ownership of their own children, to live and work as you see fit, without someone telling you what to do and how to do it. Essential to the former slaves' idea of liberty and happiness was the ownership of land. To finally own a piece of property for themselves in which they could provide for their own subsistence and finally reap some of the benefits of their own labor, which had enriched this country for centuries. The 13th Amendment was not perfect. The 13th Amendment, for instance, banned slavery and involuntary servitude, except in instances when a crime is committed. Consequently, this loophole created a milieu in which Frederick Douglass described it as slavery by another name. What the enslaved people thought would have been a new beginning in America, to be finally included in this American democratic experience, turned out to be one in which they would be hit hard by prejudice, violence would be used to undercut their dreams and aspirations. And while the former enslaved people went about their business trying to reunite families and to secure a better future, white supremacists in this country begin to devise a system in which their dreams would be crushed. It is at this point that we move to what is known as Reconstruction. Current scholarships being produced by historian Carl Anderson, as well as others like Ta-Nehisi Coates, who studied the current conditions of African Americans in the United States today, builds on themes that W.E.B. Du Bois covered in his seminal work, The Souls of Black Folk. In this work, Du Bois linked the African American struggle to get an education, to vote, to live and worship where they wanted, and to choose a profession for themselves, to a larger battle for the spiritual well-being, or what Du Bois called the souls of black folk. Du Bois was troubled by the conditions in which he saw an increasing hostile and repressive society emerging, in which African Americans' hopes, dreams, and aspirations of first-class citizenship, an advancement and an equal footing with other groups, was being brushed aside, being rooted out by violence and indifference. An indifference towards the physical and spiritual welfare of African Americans that was being ignored. After 250 years of unpaid labor, which helped to make the United States one of the wealthiest nations in the world, efforts to make African Americans finally citizens of this country were met with widespread opposition in the South as well as in the North. Even the most staunchest abolitionists, such as Massachusetts Senator Charles Sumner, now viewed African Americans as unworthy of citizenship. A class of people that had previously, before the Civil War, been viewed as the most hardworking and productive in America were now being classed as lazy. A people who white men went off toward the Civil War and left behind to protect their wives and daughters were now viewed as innately criminal and predatory. And therefore, it demanded the most repressive regime to put them in their place. It is under these conditions that African Americans would suffer, and it would be these developments that would motivate W.E.B. Du Bois to contextualize what he called the Negro problem. But really, what Du Bois wanted to point out, it was an American problem. An American problem rooted in prejudice. An American problem rooted in this propensity to subject the other to violence, to pain. But in fact, African Americans have always been here. And in fact, African Americans were here on the North American continent before the British. They came with the Spaniards, Fort Augustine, Florida, the oldest European city on the North American continent was founded with the aid of African Americans, and they would not give up.
Emancipation, doesn't that sound wonderful? In Rockin' Jerusalem, you will hear the text, New Jerusalem. Well, substitute that text in your minds for the African descendants as New America, all the hope that was embodied.
Oh, Mary, ring the bells. Oh, Hello, everyone. This is a poem titled Almighty Death by W.E.B. DuBois. Softly, quite softly, for I hear above the murmur of the sea, faint and far fallen footsteps, as of one who comes out from beyond the endless ends of time, with voice that downward looms through singing stars. Its subtle sound I see through these long, darkened eyes. I hear the light he bringeth on his hands, almighty death. Softly, oh softly, lest he pass me by. And that unquivering light toward which my longing soul and tortured body through these years have writhed, fade to the dun darkness of my days. Softly, full softly, let me rise and greet the strong, low looting of that long-awaited call. Swiftly be all my good and going gone. In this vast, veiled, and vanquished vigor of my soul, seek somehow, otherwhere, its rest and goal. Where endless spaces stretch, where endless time doth moan, where endless life doth pour, through the black kingdoms of eternal death. Then haply I may see what things I have not seen. Then I may know what things I have not known. Then I may do my dreams. Farewell. No sound of idle mourning let there be to shudder this full silence, save the voice of children, little children, white and black, whispering the deeds I tried to do for them, while I at last, unguided and alone, pass softly, full softly.
Every African-American child, man or woman, is familiar with the broken promise of 40 acres of the mule. It represents more than just a slap in the face to a people who have contributed most significantly to what this country is today. 40 acres and a mule harkens back to a time when African Americans were asked, or when America asked, what is to be done to or with the former slaves? Should we deport them, send them back to Africa, to Liberia? Should we send them to South or Central America, Panama, to Haiti, to Jamaica? If you do that, what happens to the South that needs rebuilding? Who's going to grow the cotton? Who's going to grow the corn? Who's going to grow the rice? Who's going to feed America? Just couldn't happen. African Americans, however, had no intention of going back to producing for the white people of this country. They wanted land so that they can create some prosperity for themselves. The promise was made, the promise was broken. It is something that has remained dear to African Americans, very close to their heart, because it reminds them of the ways in which they have been treated as second-class citizens from the very beginning. While the Japanese have received compensation for their internment in concentration camps during World War II, and while others, such as the Jewish community, can reflect upon the fact that they have received some compensation for the injustices that they have faced at the hands of the Nazis, African Americans have yet to receive their due share. Now, I don't want to say that there wasn't any progress made after slavery ended, for there were. The Civil War has produced what many call a revolution. 4 million people that had endured slavery, 250 years of slavery, were liberated and would be given rights as citizens. but this would be short-lived. During Reconstruction, approximately from the period 1865 to about 1870, and my dean might correct me on my timeline, because everyone has a different idea about when Reconstruction started, when it ended. There was some progress for civil rights for African Americans, but these, as I mentioned, were short-lived. Nonetheless, the most significant of these were molded in what is called the Reconstruction Acts. The passage of the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, for example, the 13th abolished slavery, the 14th guaranteed citizenship and equal protection of the laws, and granted the right to vote to newly freed slaves in the 15th Amendment. But let us not forget that whereas the Civil Rights Amendments ratified between 1865 and 1870 expanded rights for former slaves and their descendants, the effectiveness of these laws were undone eventually by what Carl Anderson calls white rage, this backlash that continues till this day, this unraveling of these rights, the undermining of these rights, and the indifference of some towards these injustices. Almost as quickly as these rights were given, they were taken away through violence, terrorist groups such as the KKK, with the constitutional protection of this country, especially the highest court in the land, where law enforcement officers participated, judges, county clerks, in a systemic and relentless program to undermine the former slaves. According to Anderson, white rage has undermined democracy, warped the Constitution, weakened the nation's ability to compete economically, squandered billions of dollars in baseless incarceration, rendered an entire region sick, poor, and woefully undereducated, and left cities no less than decimated. Although the former Confederate states were required to ratify the 13th Amendment to be readmitted back into the Union, some passed laws that also restricted the liberties of former slaves, effectively re-enslaving the entire Southern Black population. These reincarnated slave codes, or black codes as they're more commonly referred, denied most legal rights to the freedmen by prohibiting them from voting, sitting on juries, giving testimonies in court against white folks, or appearing in public. Black codes often empowered local law enforcement authorities to arrest black Americans and impose fines for things like vagrancy. Previously normal behaviors now became loitering. To be unemployed could land you in jail. As a result, many states established what is called the convict leasing system, where white plantation owners and businessmen like Andrew Carnegie, the same Andrew Carnegie that we heard of, who pulled himself up by his bootstraps, relied on convict leasing to mine for coal, to man his factories, and help build his wealth. Till this day, 150 years after the passage of the 13th Amendment, we still have African Americans in prisons and jails or corporate factories within the prison industrial complex continue to exploit the labor of close to 1 million African Americans. Moreover, the mass incarceration of poor African Americans for nonviolent crimes and the disproportionate application of the death penalty evidence the indifferent attitudes that most Americans have towards the plight of African Americans, as well as this ongoing struggle for equality and justice. One of the most significant of the Reconstruction Acts is the 14th Amendment, which was proposed in 1866 and finally ratified in 1868. It guaranteed birthright citizenship for the former slaves or anyone born or naturalized in the United States or its territories. It barred the states from abridging the privileges and immunities of citizenship or depriving any person of life, liberty, or property without due process of the law. Another key feature of the 14th Amendment is the Equal Protection Clause, which prohibits states from denying any person within their jurisdiction the equal protection of the law. Part of the problem with this very important amendment, as far as African Americans are concerned till this day, is that it did not mandate integration of the races or precluded private discrimination. I'm going to speak some more about the 14th Amendment, but before I do that, I want to talk about the 15th Amendment, because it also had some limitations. The 15th Amendment was also passed in 1869 and ratified in 1870, guaranteeing the rights of citizens to vote regardless of their race, color, or previous condition of servitude. In addition to failing to include sex, which would have expanded the franchise to women, the 15th Amendment granted the right to vote, but it left it up to the states to establish eligibility. However, the southern states continued to resist efforts to establish equal treatment for African Americans. They continued to put up barriers to voting in the form of the poll tax, which you had to pay a penalty to vote. And in fact, African Americans oftentimes found that when they went to the register, they required a receipt. When you go to the tax man to pay your taxes, he refused to take it because the objective is not for you to vote. The southern states continued resistance. To remedy these shortcomings, a Civil Rights Act, not the Civil Rights Act we know of today that was passed in the latter half of the 20th century, but a Civil Rights Act was proposed and passed in 1875, designed to grant equal access for African Americans to the ballot and in public accommodations, in theater, restaurants, and transportation. Now, many of us today see the institution of the Supreme Court, the United States Supreme Court, as perhaps one of the most important protectors of the rights of ordinary African Americans and other minority groups. This institution, however, issued a series of court rulings that signal a retreat from the promise of justice based on equal rights for all citizens. It gutted the Civil Rights Act. In 1873, probably one of the most significant of these cases were the slaughterhouse cases, in which the court found that the 14th Amendment covered only federal citizenship rights. Besides habeas corpus, or the right to assemble peacefully, citizens had to seek protection from the states and its institutions. The court also said in 1875, in another ruling, that the 15th Amendment did not guarantee the right to vote to anyone. It only prevented the states from giving preferences to one citizen over another or on account of race or color. In other words, what the Supreme Court achieved was to establish a system in which the right to vote came not from the federal government, but from the states. Regardless of whatever the Constitution says, the Supreme Court affirmed the rights of states to make the final determination. This meant that the people with the greatest need for protection was left vulnerable to the abuses of their former masters and abusers. After a long, long civil rights movement in that really came to fore in the middle of the 20th century, years of legal discrimination and private prejudice against Black Americans, particularly in the South, but also in the North, the U.S. Congress eventually passed sweeping anti-discrimination legislation in the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and again the Voting Rights Act of 1965. The Civil Rights Act in particular banned discrimination in employment, public accommodation, and education based on race, creed, color, and national origin or sex. Over the years, prohibition based on pregnancy and disability were also added to the Civil Rights Act. But the civil rights, when we think about the need for a Civil Rights Act at the end of the 20th century, we must go back to the Reconstruction period and after, the first decade after that. The Civil Rights Act of 1863 involved the civil rights cases in which the Supreme Court gutted the original Civil Rights Act, demonstrate the extent to which the cards were stacked against African Americans and the ways in which whatever striving African Americans were trying to make in this country would be undermined at every turn. In the civil rights cases of 1865, involving five cases where private individuals were convicted of refusing to provide accommodation to African Americans in theaters, restaurants, and railroads, the court ruled that Congress could not prohibit private discrimination and that only the states could enforce the 14th Amendment. That ruling remained the basis for most of the prejudice in which African Americans confronted. It was not until the Civil Rights Act of 1964, in which the Congress says, now and forever, if you receive federal funding, you will be penalized. You could be punished for discriminating against anyone. It's only when the federal government was forced by the actions of African Americans and allies that we finally had an enforcement mechanism that really made the promise of freedom and equality and justice likely to take place eventually, probably another decade or two or three or four. The important thing is that W.E.B. Du Bois was at the foundation of that. And what we're going to talk about next is Reconstruction, the demise of Reconstruction, and the coming of Jim Crow. And with that, I turn it over to my colleagues.
Thank you. Harlem Shake by County Cullen. This is not water running here. These thick, rebellious streams that hurtle flesh and bone past fear down alleyways of dreams. This is a wine that must flow on, not caring how or where, so it has ways to flow upon where song is in the air. So it can woo the artful flute with loose, elastic lips, its measurements of joy compute with blithe, ecstatic hips.
While the U.S. government has long played an important role in the granting and enforcing of civil rights for Black Americans, it has also been complicit in the undermining of those rights. Beginning with the peculiar institution of slavery, the U.S. Congress, the executive, as well as the judiciary branches of the U.S. government has played an important role in the exploitation and oppression of African Americans. One way in which it has been more pronounced or evident is in the ways in which it facilitated or allowed white supremacist groups, white terrorist groups like groups like the KKK, to use violence to deny African Americans of their constitutional right to vote and to hold public office. The KKK and other white supremacist groups often use brute force to undermine the power of the black vote. There is the Colfax Massacre of 1873 in Grand Parish, Louisiana, where upwards of 105 to 280 black citizens were slaughtered by former Confederate rebels using high-powered guns, cannons, where black citizens who had voted in large numbers in the election of 1870 to help re-elect President Grant sought to defend the courthouse, the seat of power for Grand Parish, against a brutal takeover by white supremacists. These groups not only fired upon innocent citizens, but they burnt the courthouse with American citizens inside. These people were killed because they exercised their constitutional right to vote, to hold public office, and to assemble peacefully. The resulting indictment of a few of the perpetrators resulted in a conviction, which eventually worked its way up to the U.S. Supreme Court. In 1875, in U.S. v. Cruikshank, the trial of William Cruikshank and others, under what is known as the Enforcement Act of 1870, which Congress enacted to protect black people from the KKK, specifically. The Enforcement Act made it illegal for two or more persons to conspire to deprive anyone of their constitutional rights, that is to vote or to assemble. The purpose of this act was the elimination of the KKK, but in actuality, it simply forced them to go underground. In its decision, the U.S. Supreme Court dismissed the Cruikshank case on a technicality, as it often did. The justices argued that the Due Process Clause and the Equal Protection Clause of the 14th Amendment applies only to state action, not to the action of individual citizens or terrorist groups. You see, the federal government cannot hold, it argues, private citizens accountable for actions against other private citizens. You can murder African Americans with impunity, without fear of being prosecuted by the federal government. Because what the Supreme Court says is that it's state government that enforce criminal laws and try individuals for murder, not the federal government. Imagine KKK members. Who do they fear? Their neighbors? Their brothers? Their hunting buddies? No. That would not stop them from committing atrocities. The court also said that the 14th Amendment right to assemble was not intended to limit the powers of the state government in respect to their own citizens, only the federal government. The right to bear arms is not guaranteed by the Constitution. It only restricts the national government from infringing upon the rights to bear arms. The justices also argued that only the states can try a citizen for act of terror, not the federal government. Essentially, this was the beginning of the end of Reconstruction. We often hear that Reconstruction ended with the Compromise of 1878, which brought Rutherford B. Hayes into government, into the presidency. I believe, and our scholars are now beginning to argue, that it is these cases, these rulings by the U.S. Supreme Court that undermined federal authority and led to a broader national consensus that abandoned the pursuit of justice and equality for African Americans and brought about what we know as Jim Crow. So the states, rather than the federal government, enforces criminal laws. Murder or lynching, therefore, is not a crime that is tried in federal courts, but in state courts. The significance is that it would be okay to lynch black folks without fear of prosecution, or no regard for their 14th or 15th Amendment rights. So contradictory. The period from 1895 to 1900, there was an average of 101 black folks that were lynched each year, mostly in the South. Interestingly, today, new research suggests that black men are being killed by police officers in greater numbers on average than lynching at the height of the Jim Crow period. That happened within a larger context in which this Supreme Court of the United States continues to allow police officers to use their own judgment to judge within a few seconds whether someone deserved to live or to die. That harkens back to the Jim Crow period. What is lynching, you might ask? Lynching is the illegal, often public, killing of an accused person by a mob, depriving an individual of their constitutional right to a trial and a jury of their peers. The total number of persons lynched by race from 1882 to 1944 is as followed. Total, we had 4,708 persons lynched in this country, the United States. Of that number, 3,417 were African American citizens, and only 1,291 white Americans. There is also the problem of rape. Rebecca Lattimore Felton, who has the distinction of being the first woman to serve in the U.S. Senate, mind you, only for a day, she was appointed for only a day, had a pro-lynch, she was a pro-lynching advocate from Georgia. And she called on white men to protect white women from what she called and others call the threat of the black brute. Now let's consider Felton's argument about white women needing protection from black men. There is Ida B. Wells, on the other hand, the anti-lynching crusader and journalist. Through her research, Ida B. Wells argued and found out that lynching was used to intimidate African Americans and to undermine their economic progress in America. What Felton and others argued was a threat to white America, Ida B. Wells argued was a disguise for white privilege, for white rage against black progress. Segregation spread through most spheres of Southern life, almost entirely barred African Americans from voting and from serving on Southern juries. To vote means that your name is likely to be called for jury service. When your sister, your mother, is sexually violated, and a jury is not representative, or your class of people or race of people is not represented on the voter rolls, the chances of you being on a jury to hold those perpetrators accountable is nil. Most social scientists as well agreed that the black race was biologically inferior. So when we put all this into context, we see what scholars refer to as the nadir, or a reversal of the progress that was made during the Reconstruction period. Racial segregation, or Jim Crow, was a system derived from the efforts of white Americans to keep black Americans in a subordinate status by denying them equal access to public facilities and ensuring that blacks lived separately and apart from white Americans. Although segregation existed throughout the United States before the Civil War, Jim Crow was created in the 1890s to control blacks and to deny them opportunities guaranteed to white Americans. Jim Crow had broad support nationally. It wasn't just a Southern thing. If we look at the states that passed constitutions or developed constitutions that disenfranchised African Americans, in 1890, Mississippi, in 1895, South Carolina, Louisiana in 1898, North Carolina in 1900, Virginia and Alabama in 1902, and Georgia and Texas in 1908. What this signals is a capitulation to Jim Crow, an accommodation to Jim Crow, and it's one in which the federal government was at the forefront. In its 1896 Supreme Court ruling, Plessy v. Ferguson, the federal government signaled its capitulation to the Southern way of life. The federal government, through the Supreme Court, gave constitutional legitimacy to Jim Crow laws when it established the principle of separate but equal. But in fact, separate was never equal, in that African Americans receive less protection and less resources from their state governments, even though they paid taxes, than their white peers. We had de jure written laws that proliferated across the South, and de facto unwritten but manifested through custom segregation, which continued in the North as well. Booker T. Washington, the the white appointed leader of Southern blacks. In 1895, in Atlanta, Georgia, gave a speech or a lecture that became known as the Compromise, the Great Compromise, in which he acquiesced or yielded to racial segregation and the continued disenfranchisement of African Americans. He argued for blacks to pursue industrial education and economic advancement and to forego their constitutional rights as citizens of this country. He asked them to cast down their buckets and remain in the South and not to migrate from the South. He argued that we can be as one as the hand, but as separate as the fingers. His Atlanta Exposition speech, or the Atlanta Compromise, set the tone for black leadership until W.E.B. Du Bois took up the mantle to offer an alternative. Du Bois, although he was a sociologist and a historian, he was also a philosopher who studied classical Greek philosophy. And he understood that in ancient Greece, slave masters receive a classical education, and it was the slaves who receive a vocational trade. And he would have none of that for African Americans. He believed in first-class citizenship, and he believed in the potential for African Americans to do well if given the same opportunities as everyone else. Du Bois understood, therefore, that African Americans, especially those who he called the talented tent, the 10% that represent the brightest in the community, if they so choose to pursue medicine or law, if they so choose to attend Harvard or Princeton or Tuskegee Institute, it should be their choice, and there should not be a system in place to tell them when and where or what to do. He believed education and the education of men should be foremost important rather than training men to participate in a capitalist industrial society. The most talented tent, he argued, should receive a classical education or a liberal arts education because they would be the future leaders of tomorrow. A liberal arts education, he argued, was good for the black race as well as for the entire nation. It's about developing citizens. He also argued that it was unacceptable to abdicate your constitutional rights. Each person, he argued, should enjoy equal access to economic and educational opportunities regardless of their race. And so he advocated for intra-racial strategy to end Jim Crow. In the Niagara Movement and the NAACP, in which he was a founding member, we see where W.E.B. Du Bois developed a strategy for confronting the problem of the color line, the American problem, the economic and social justice that was denied to African Americans should not remain hidden behind a veil based on race. You should expose it. We should confront it head on. I think the most basic question Du Bois asks us to wrestle with is, how does it feel to be a problem in your own country, your own country of birth, the country of your forefathers? The state of American apartheid manifested itself through Jim Crow laws and customs. I wish I could speak to you some more from a personal point of view, but I can't do that. You see, I didn't live through the Jim Crow period. Fortunately for you and for myself, we have someone who grew up under the Jim Crow period and has agreed to bless us with her presence here today. I want to introduce Dr. Joyce Gibson, who is Dean of the Lewiston Auburn College here at USM, and someone who is a mentor to me here at USM, and someone that we are fortunate to have in this community. And so I'm going to take my leave and encourage you to listen carefully to what Dr. Gibson has to share with us. Thank you.
Good evening, y'all. Still here. I will be speaking to you shortly about my experience growing up in Mississippi during segregated periods, and I believe, as I look through the audience, I have some people in my generation who could also add to that experience. But I will be sharing just sort of short vignettes of my experience with my parents and my siblings growing up in Mississippi and how social justice became my mantra, as with my parents and many of my siblings, and is also the reason I'm here at the University of Southern Maine. I'll give you a little bit of that, you know, after the next song and poem. Thank you.
So while our choir gets reconfigured, I'll just talk to you a little bit about the song Signs of Judgment. Today we heard about slavery, the promise of freedom, disappointment. If you noticed, every single one of these songs, these slave songs, always ended up in death. Always ended up, life will be better when you're dead. That seems pretty awful to think about, that the only hope you had for freedom, for justice, for equality, was after you've lived this life. The signs of judgment still encompasses that idea. However, signs of judgment want us all to think about what judgment means, what an indictment DuBois had on the way the American system towards African Americans seemed to be broken. We're in the 21st century. We've elected an African-American president. Many may have viewed that as things have finally changed. Have they? When we have Harvard professors being arrested in their own homes, have we really changed that much? When we think about the statistics, which I won't go through, have we really changed? Is the hope for the African American still in the afterlife? Is the hope for freedom, the hope for equality, waiting in the afterlife? Or can we still move forward in this life?
Judgment, judgment to come in judgment. O Southland by James Weldon Johnson. O Southland, O Southland, have you not heard the call? The trumpet blown, the word made known to the nations one and all. The watchword, the hope word, salvation's present plan. A gospel new for all, for you, man shall be saved by man. O Southland, do you not hear today the mighty beat of onward feet, and know you not their way? Tis forward, tis upward, onto the fair white arch of freedom's dome, and there is room for each man who would march. O Southland, fair Southland, then why do you still cling to an idle age and a musty page, to a dead and useless thing? Tis springtime, tis work time, the world is young again, and God's above, and God is love, and men are only men. O Southland, my Southland, O birthland, do not shirk the toilsome task, nor respite ask, but gird you for the work. Remember, remember, that weakness stalks in pride, that he is strong who helps along the faint one at his side.
Well, it's time for us to have a conversation, y'all. I first would like to just thank the students. This has been an amazing night. The choir is just incredible, and the bravery of the students in their poems has just been outstanding. Woo! Just so you already know, that you've guessed that I'm the wrap-up person. So this is going to be more brief, but we want to engage you, and we've put up the microphones, I think, for you to ask questions and to have conversation with us. I guess I'm revealing for the first time to some of my faculty who are here that I'm older than I look. But I grew up in Mississippi, another M. I grew up in Mississippi, married a guy from Massachusetts, and I worked almost the last decade in Maine. And most of my life has been about addressing social justice issues, primarily through education. And I'll just say briefly that what attracted me to even apply for the position at Lewis and Auburn College was because that community understood the value of education for its people, and a lot of its people were Franco-Americans who had been treated almost as roughly as African-Americans in this country. And they saw, and I saw, a need to be part of first-generation peoples who could use education to improve themselves, to improve the society at large, and to do some of the things that you've seen tonight. It's just amazing. So that's one of the reasons I'm here in Maine, because of a social justice issue. So let me explain a little bit about my family. Both my parents were from farming families. My father's deceased about 2 years now. My mother's still alive and 92 and still giving instructions. You know how moms are. We were told repeatedly that education was the way you got ahead. Not just for black people, but especially for us, but in America. That was something nobody could take away from you. Now, we're in a community where there are signs for whites here, blacks here. And my parents tried to protect us from a lot of that because they didn't want us to be infected with the power game that was going on and so many things that were part of our everyday life. But they told us some very interesting things. They were religious people, and they said to us, and this is something I always remember and have to repeat to my sisters and brothers sometimes, that every white person you meet is not against you. And every black person you meet is not for you. You have to seek what's in a person's heart, judge people individually and not as groups. And that's been part of me for a very long time. And if you know your history and you've learned some tonight, you know that we as a black people have not been able to address the struggle without the collaboration of many other peoples to make the progress that we have. And yes, we are still struggling. There are so many things going on today that Leroy pointed out that are eerily like things that were going on hundreds of years ago, but who was it? Maya Angelou, Still We Rise. We struggle, we work together to make things happen. So a few quick things that I remember so well, it's almost like yesterday. When we would have to stop at a gas station to get gas in Mississippi, if we weren't in a black neighborhood, obviously the other gas stations were owned by white people. So the attendant would come out and start to put the gas in my father's in the gas tank, and my father would, you guys go to the bathroom. And the guy would say, you can't use the bathroom here. And my father would say, but we can't get gas here either. Talk about riding on fumes a lot. We did that, but my people were very principled, and we didn't do that. We spent a lot of time, the girls, between two car doors, going to the bathroom on the side of the road while the guys walked into the woods. But, you know, that was just the way it was. I have memories of just going to the store to buy things, and you would be in line behind other women, usually, buying things, and often the attendant would take the white person behind you and skip you to ring up their purchase. And my mother, you have to know her, y'all. She would say, hold it. We were in line, and we're next. It's only fair that you take our purchases. Most of the time, she could manage that. When she couldn't, and people wanted to insist on skipping us, she would say, take this merchandise, we're leaving. So we didn't have a lot of control over some of the things that happened. We could control our reactions to things that we couldn't control, right? One thing I want to particularly tell you about is when my father got out of the service, he told us this story. Years later, because we were pretty young, when the decision about Brown v. Board of Education that determined that the educational institutions were separate and unequal, and that was unconstitutional, my father was practicing dentistry in Vicksburg, Mississippi. He had been in the Army, actually had gotten part of his undergraduate degree through the University of Pennsylvania through the Army, and then had finished his doctor of dental medicine at Howard University. So he was practicing in Vicksburg, obviously in a black section. But the medical officer who signed his deferment was a white medical officer who signed deferments for all the men who got out of the Army early after the war was over, right? So, hallelujah, Brown v. Board of Education. We were in segregated schools across the track somewhere in the woods, and we would actually be riding segregated buses. The white kids were in the front, and we were in the back. So when the decision was made, and you all remember that phrase that was part of the ruling, with all deliberate speed. Y'all know that didn't happen, right? All deliberate speed took decades to occur, but there was a meeting called of all of the medical community, dentists, doctors, physicians, nurses, everybody, to talk about this decision. And my father, who was want to write essays about social justice and to win awards, actually, for his essays and his work, was a pretty outspoken person. And when the head of the medical community asked, well, what do the black people in the medical community think about this decision? Nobody spoke up but my father. And there were five of us then. There were ultimately six of us kids. And he got up and said, damn, it's the best thing that's ever happened to us. Our kids get educated, because at the time, we were not only sitting in the back of the bus, we were going to schools that were neglected in terms of the buildings and the structures, and we never got new books. We got books that were hand-me-downs from the white kids the year before. We never got new books. So he was elated, and guess what? He didn't get his deferment signed that year. He had to go back into the service. There is a silver lining, folks, because it was the best thing. There were five of us. We were living in segregated housing. Now that we were part of the Air Force, my father chose the Air Force, we had wonderful housing. We had integrated service. We had great medical service. So, you know, sometimes lemons do turn into lemonade. So that was a very tough thing for my dad to do because he was disappointed in his colleagues who said nothing, you know, and in the medical community who he was trying to serve. So it was a tough but a courageous decision. Those kinds of examples were great for me in terms of my own work in higher education in particular. Before I got here to the University of Southern Maine, I was always a part of a women's caucus or a black caucus or a gay caucus for rights on higher education campuses, because higher education is a part of regular society and it's often structured like that, and discrimination was occurring. And for the longest time, you didn't even have students of color on campus, and you certainly didn't have people coming out on campuses in terms of their different sexual orientation. So what I want you to hear from what I'm sharing with you tonight is that if you believe in social justice, one, there are other people who believe like you and you whom you can collaborate with to make progress. Second, if you believe in social justice, you don't believe in it for just one group. You believe in social justice for everybody, because we can always find a group to discriminate against or to say is the underdog. Today, it's new immigrants. Today, it's still African-American men. Today, it's gay people. Today, it's European groups that are being bombed out of their countries and their homes. We're trying to make restrictions. We have lots of history. America has lots of history for discriminating against Jews, Chinese, Japanese, you name it. People in power have to have power taken from them. And since we have laws, ultimately we have laws that help protect us, when you believe in social justice, you have to believe in it all the way. So I'm going to leave you to kick off our discussion with a quote from Plato, who said, "Justice will only be achieved when those who do not suffer justice injustice for those who do when those who do not suffer injustice feel the same outrage as those who do." So now we can have your questions and your comments about tonight's fabulous program.
Are there any questions from the audience for any of us here? There's a gentleman in the back there.
Hi, I'm Nick. So I studied sociology in university, but the only time W.E.B. Du Bois' name came up was during sections on slavery and other disciplines. I'm curious, within the academic disciplines, why I feel like he hasn't gotten as much recognition within academia for being a sociologist and one of the most preeminent sociologists in the American school. So I'd like to hear, because I don't know that much about him, his academic work. I'd like to hear a little bit about that and how his recognition within academia might have changed. Even recently, I've seen more things talking about him and his sociology work specifically. So I'm wondering if you have any knowledge about that.
Good question. I think there's a lot of scholarship on W.E.B. Du Bois. There's a recent book by Stephanie Shaw that's published through University of North Carolina Press, in which she systematically goes through the soul of black folk and does break every chapter down. And what it reveals to me is the complexity of W.E.B. Du Bois, the ways in which this one manuscript has so many different layers We're talking about history, sociology, philosophy. You know, he was a pragmatist, right? And many would argue, in his own right, a leading philosopher. And music or songs. You know, he begins every chapter of The Soul of Black Folk with a sorrow song, because he really, I think what Stephanie Shaw argues is that Du Bois was so concerned with the souls of Black folk from a spiritual perspective, right? And he was worried about what's happening to African Americans, that they're losing that part of their identity, which is so spiritual and so soulful. Now, on the one hand, Du Bois went through various different transformations throughout his life. Not only was he for a long time the villain to the accommodationist perspective of how race relations would be handled in America, the one in which African Americans would be subservient to white Americans and would go this go slow principle that eventually you'll get your rights, but it might be 100 years, it might be 200 years from now, you must prove yourselves first. And Du Bois wasn't having any of that. He believed in the immediate result, and that we should work earnestly towards gaining and maintaining whatever rights every other American had at the time. But later on, he became very frustrated with the pace of which things were happening in America, and he turned to socialism and communism, and eventually he left this country, went to Africa, and I think his remains is still in Ghana. How much does that have to do with how little we know about Du Bois today? That had a lot to do with it, I think. The way in which we celebrate a Martin Luther King, but Du Bois, who is probably the foremost civil rights activist of the 20th century, the person who helped founded the NAACP, which is by far the most significant civil rights organization in America today, that sets a model that based on coalition between various different groups working towards the mission for social justice. I do know that at some institutions, W.E.B. Du Bois' work is taught widely. And the University of Maine, for example, Honors College teaches The Soul of Black Folk every year. Maybe USM needs to do that a little bit more.
As I've been reading both Du Bois and Booker T. Washington, the significance and importance of their education themselves, Du Bois having been born free, Washington having been born a slave, is very striking. And as you've alluded to, they are frequently described in their approaches to educating the freed slaves and their descendants as being sort of opposed to each other. And I wonder if that's how you see it, or if you see any complementariness in their approaches to education.
Excellent question. I see in Washington and Du Bois, a situation in which, on the one hand, we have to understand that there are 4 million African Americans coming out of slavery. What we have been taught is that most of these people couldn't read and write. But how many of these people willingly volunteered the information that they could read and write? Doing so could have gotten you in trouble. We also have to remember as well that there is a significant presence of freed African Americans who have always been free or have been free for generations, who had access to education and was well prepared to reap the benefits of emancipation and citizenship, but was held back by a systematic effort to undermine those rights. And I think while I can understand Washington's argument that the vast majority of African Americans will need what is called the Tuskegee Hampton model of citizenship, one in which African Americans receive a vocational skill, they receive moral training. There are a large cross-section of the black population that is as prepared and as fit for citizenship as any other group. And those were the people that W.E.B. Du Bois was talking about that needs to have that freedom to prosper. Not every African American was raised in the same way that a Washington or the vast majority of Southern blacks were raised. You had individuals like W.E.B. Du Bois who grew up in a context in which they receive excellent education. She mentioned the fact that Du Bois was the first African American to receive a PhD from Harvard. That's an excellent point, but it's also clear that Du Bois wasn't the first to attend Harvard. You know, there are African Americans who had received bachelor's and master's degree from Harvard, as well as many other leading institutions. If you look at the number of African Americans who practiced law at the end of are during the Reconstruction period through to the early 20th century, it's significant. If you look at the fact that Reconstruction governments were led by mulatto or mixed race Africans, Louisiana, for example, elected the first mixed race person to be a governor in the United States. Because in Louisiana, we already have a significant presence of African Americans who had that education, had that background, had the aspirations, and just needed that opportunity to display their skills. You know, so I actually assigned Booker T. Washington text last year when I taught my senior seminar on biographies of black leaders, and I was shocked at how students identified with Washington's argument, but also how readily they identified the ways in which Washington's spoke out of one side of his mouth and then on the other there's something else that came out. Washington himself sent his own daughters to New England to receive a classical education, a liberal arts education, even though he told the vast majority of African Americans that vocational training was the way for them. He sent his children to New England to get a proper education because he understood the need for it. There's a hand over here.
I was just wondering why, like, in public education, you aren't really taught about African Americans who are, like, the more elite, who are wealthy and had an education. Like, when you learn about African American history, you're only taught about the slavery aspect of it. And I was wondering why that is, and, like, how can we learn more about that aspect of African American history?
We don't learn it because the publishers control content. That's the basic answer. So I think it's Texas and then New York, right? In that order, they control what happens. They control the text of public school education. So they have the money, and so they do the editing, and they edit a lot of history out that would offend the people whom they represent. So too often you have to go to after school or private groups, whether in churches or community centers, to learn your own history because it's not offered. And sometimes people have to wait to come to higher education to get it all. So unfortunately, that's the way it is.
Here.
I've got a couple of comments. First, to textbooks. If you will read the small print in your textbooks, they're often printed in English in other countries. Order the textbook from the other country. It will be more factual. They don't have a chicken in a pot to hide. I don't know. So could you speak on 40 acres and a mule, what happened there, eminent domain, and urban renewal?
I think you just knocked me out of my socks there for a moment. Now, urban renewal is something that I am not too versed in, and I probably would not be very well to address that. Maybe one of my colleagues probably would. But if we talk about the idea of African Americans and this 40 acre and a mule, you know, it's literal, but it's also more than just the literal not getting that 40 acre on a mule, right? Notwithstanding the fact how important land ownership was. But there's also the problem of reparation. It is part of this reparation problem. There is a wonderful study out there by Mary Frances Berry called My Face is Black, It's True, Collie House. And I believe the subtitle is Collie House and the Struggle for Reparations for the Former Slaves. Excellent study. If you look at Collie House, a former slave who spent the rest of her life from the end of slavery through to her death in the early 20th century, petitioning the federal government for a pension for former slaves, because it was important that individuals who worked their entire lives contributing to developing an industrial economy in this country, a nation that would become the premier economic force after World War I, and today the largest economy in the world. And for it to have had hundreds of thousands of former slaves up into the 1920s and 30s that were still around living in poverty and not given 1 cent for the work that they did, for growing that cotton. And we often talk about the cotton, right? That ran the textile mills in New England and England. But we really talk about the rice that was eaten everywhere, as well as the corn. They didn't just grow cotton. They grew other things that sustained America. If you look at the banks who benefited enormously from slavery, you know, the banks who often foreclosed on slave owners, took their slaves as property and held them in the basements of their buildings until auction day when they auctioned them off. If you look at universities like George Washington University down there in D.C. that has finally been called out after historians found in the records the fact that they have been concealing and hiding for so many decades or centuries, the fact that when that university was about to collapse, they turned to slaves and sold 239 slaves that were then used to take that institution out of virtual bankruptcy and make it into what it is today. For African Americans to then had to endure a system of Jim Crow in which they were denied access to these premier institutions that literally were built by slaves and then capitalized by slaves, you know, speaks to this continued discussion about what has gone wrong or what has been wrong for a very long time, right? And I think, you know, when we talk about the 40 acre and a mule, we're talking about more than just land. We're talking about also the issue of reparation, payment for what the work that we have done and the contributions, recognition for the contribution that we have given to this country and this society. Do you have anyone have anything to add to that? Thank you for that important question. Anyone else? Oh, we have a few hands up. There's one in the middle here as well.
Hello. This question is directed for Dr. Gibson.
Can you speak a little louder, please?
Hi. This is directed for Dr. Gibson in response or in her citing of Plato. So Hannah Arendt, following the Eichmann and Jerusalem trial, she expressed concern about subsequent generations of German youth expressing what she described as cheap sentimentality in response to the atrocities of the Holocaust, that they would express overt emotional responses, but that it would lead to very little action. How do we, in our current situation, still facing issues of racial discrimination and other types of discrimination, avoid that cheap sentimentality and really produce action towards social equality?
I think there are some good examples of people who organize to protest against discrimination and who make statements locally and nationally in their collaboration together. And I think one of the important things to do is to affiliate yourself with organizations that are making change around discrimination in whatever form against whatever group. One of the things I didn't say to you is that my family has been lifelong members of the NAACP. So we get the literature, we understand what's going on, we actually go to protests, and we contribute financially when we can, but we affiliate with NAACP and other groups that are actually bringing lawsuits or making change around discriminatory acts. There is actually a group in Maine called Stand Up Against Racism. They are on the corner in Auburn, Maine, near where I live. The first Monday, I believe, anybody here belong to Surge? The first Monday of every month, reminding people about discrimination, you know, racial discrimination in particular, you know, in our area. There are other groups that make it their business to, well, I'm on the board of the ACLU, for example, and we make big statements about discriminatory acts all over Maine, whether it's for women, whether it's for immigrant groups, whether it's for the people who remember the protest against people standing in the median strips to ask for money. Remember that? It was just, I think, last year. Well, people stand there holding signs for you to vote for somebody, but they were trying to keep people from asking for money using those medians. Well, the ACLU took Portland to court, and we won that. You know, people have a right to stand and protest or do whatever they think they need to do on public property in Portland now. So I think if you affiliate yourself with groups that are making change and become a part of that, nothing will be shallow about your contribution or the history that you're making for that group of those people.
You hear a lot about cultural appropriation these days, and I was wondering how deep does the history of Black culture being appropriated go? Was it appropriated as far back as when DuBois and people like Douglass and other prominent people? Does it go back that far, or has this become a new thing?
Another excellent question. I want to point out to you that next Wednesday at Space Gallery, the Sampson Center for Diversity here at USM is sponsoring an event in which there will be a film shown about the collection of Black related memorabilia and the politics behind that, which I think would speak directly to the question that you raised. But when we think about cultural appropriation, you know, it is not a new phenomenon. It is one that has been ongoing. Part of the problem, however, is that for a very long time, African-American culture was ridiculed and abused. If we think of minstrel shows in which performers depicted the character of African-Americans to suggest that, for example, African-Americans were childlike, that African-Americans were not smart, you know, just stupid or silly, and uncultured. But I think where we are today, you know, we see, for example, the best reggae album is actually a British artist, right? They have won that. And my brother called me up and be like, what is going on? You know, that doesn't sound like reggae. You know, why did this person win and blah, blah. And I said, you know, it's all great, man. It's music. You know, from my perspective, you know, so for example, if you look at reggae, it is no longer a Jamaican thing. It's a world music. And so the more opportunities for people to participate and share into our culture, I see it as a positive thing. What I don't like, and what most African Americans do not like, is when on the one hand you ridicule African Americans for their culture, but turn around and think it's fun and cool to wear your hair a certain way, to dress a certain way, because you can get away with it, because at the end of the day you can throw that off and become, let's say, white again, or whoever you want to be. But we can't do that. You know, we can't do that. I remember growing up watching my uncles with their dreadlocks, and I said to my grandmother, I want to do dreadlocks. And she sat me down and mentioned that if you dread in this house, you got to get out. And she did allow me to participate and pretended to be Rasta without having the law. You know, I'm a vegetarian. I eat well. I try to eat like my uncles did growing up, but I just can't wear my dreadlock. And I'm still working on it. Eventually, I will get there. Don't be surprised if you see a dreadlock guy come into your class one day to teach. It's coming to you someday soon.
I would like to thank the university for having courage to address the greatest challenge that is facing our country. And I'd like to thank you for putting it in a historical context. I'm also going to make an assumption that this conversation will continue outside of this room in some way, which will add value to the presentation tonight. Would you speak just for a moment? We could have a rich conversation about when Reconstruction ended, but with your permission, I would submit that the Plessy v. Ferguson decision in 1896 did something that continues to impact our society. And W.E.B. Du Bois, with the Niagara Movement in the early 1900s, were responding to that decision. I thought you were going to say, when you spoke about Plessy, that decision made segregation, made discrimination legal in the United States of America. And we are still living with the legacy of that Supreme Court decision. And even though Brown v. Board in 1954 overturned that decision, as you very skillfully pointed out, it was not until the 60s that LBJ was successful in getting civil rights legislation. My question to you is, why are we still having this conversation around equity life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness in the United States? Why are we still having that conversation?
That is mine. My God, that is so pointed. I think to an extent, I downplayed Plessy, which I shouldn't have. But I also wanted to reinforce that by the time we get to Plessy, everything, the house has already fallen. The roof had already been burning for 20 years or so. What Plessy did was just reinforce what we already knew. If you look at the Plessy ruling, they basically cited an 1848 case out of Boston, the Roberts case, where Sarah Roberts, a young African-American girl, walked by three or four prominent white school for white kids and walked many miles to a rundown, dilapidated school for African-Americans, in which the city of Boston and the state of Massachusetts Supreme Court ruled that the fact that there's a provision for African-American education, they have met the mandate of separate but equal. You know, there is something about the African-American experience here, that the undertone here is this. Going back to the Constitutional Convention, there is already a national consensus that African-Americans were not citizens and did not deserve equal treatment, regardless of whatever progress they made. And so by the time we get to Plessy, you know, this is just icing on the cake. There is already a foundation for it that has been built or put or established through the Reconstruction years. What one hand giveth with the left, the other it took back with the right hand. And so the Plessy case, for a lot of people, basically reinforced a final nail in the coffin. But what scholars are finally doing, I think, is going back to the Reconstruction years and looking beyond Plessy and saying, what is the root? Where is this coming from? And they realized that Plessy had precedent. Plessy was building on systemic cases year after year, as well as challenges that African Americans were already mounting. We can talk about Rosa Parks, for example, and her refusal to give up her seat on the bus. But there are numerous other women, going back to Ida B. Wells, for example, in Tennessee, who challenged segregated public transportation and refused to give up her seat. You know, so there's a whole host of cases and that context for understanding why Plessy and eventually Brown would become important. So in February, I will be speaking more with more authority on Plessy. Thank you for pointing that out. To the issue of why are we still talking about this thing today, you know, I would just say briefly here, it's already spoiled, right? The way in which slavery had this, what some people call this unnatural debt, is part of that problem. The way in which slavery was ended because of a war, and not a voluntary process, not a natural coming to in which we had reconciliation, is part of the problem. There is also the thing where I talk about reparation for the slaves. That has not happened. And until
what was called for with the Kerner Commission in the 1960s after the 67-68 urban riots across America, which we said there are two Americas, one that is affluent, one that participates widely in the mainstream and enjoy most of the rewards and benefits of industrial capitalist economy. And there's another, there's a rural, impoverished white community, and there's an urban black community that has just been decimated and cut off and marginalized. And that is part of the problem. And so when you merge those two things together, you begin to see the problem. You know, the fact that there have been a process in which there are still anger. There are some people who believe that slavery should have continued much longer, and that their forefathers, their families or legacies were destroyed, because what the war actually did is that it impoverished thousands of Southerners who lived off the backs of African Americans. But then on the other hand, you also had millions of African Americans that received nothing. And coupled with that, you had the problem of redlining, which denied them opportunities to get decent housing, restrictive covenant laws that prevented them from buying or renting properties in neighborhoods that would have put their children into some of the better schools. So they end up in under-resourced schools with lack of adequate resources to really get that a decent education. All of those things contribute to some of the problems that we're still having today. There is also the problem of the end of the 19th century, the 1890 census, which begins to demonstrate that African Americans are migrating into urban communities in the Northeast as well as the Midwest. And so social scientists begin to look at this and say, okay, something is happening here. There's a revolution happening. And then what they decided to do is to look at crime statistics, and said, okay, what is this new development creating? It's creating urban crime. And African Americans who were being incarcerated for example, standing at the street corner, or for moving into a community and not yet finding some place to live, but were sent away for 5 years. Now, these numbers were tallied and became evidence for the proof that black people are more prone to commit crimes than the Irish or the Italians. So while we had Al Capone slaughtering many people in Chicago, we had black people who were arrested for example, vagrancy and given 5 to 10 years, become the standard narrative for the criminal black man, right? And till this day, we're still dealing with that problem, I think. Thank you for that question.
Thank you. kind of adding on to that last point you had, considering the criminal stereotype given to African Americans compared to someone who was of some other descent. There's an old saying, history that does not see change tends to repeat itself. Now, over the course of events, so over time, there have been just tragic events that have negatively affected how we see ourselves as Americans and how we correlate and interact with each other. And as you see today, with all the events that we've seen over the past 5 years, adding on to a point, I believe the conductor to this amazing music group here stated, have we really changed? Well, my answer to that is definitely no. Because this stereotype and racism aspect that was developed by W.E.B. DuBois, it definitely still exists today. It's just the question is, how are we able to root it out and eventually eliminate it? And speaking personally as a fourth generation Italian American, that doesn't necessarily mean I'm a member of the mafia. Am I right? So it's definitely, how does that influence everyone as a whole, everyone that is in this country as a citizen, given that right by the 14th Amendment, how does racism finally be eliminated because of these stereotypes and this prejudice that has existed for such a long time? And that's a question we still struggle to answer today. What would W.E.B. DuBois say to that if he were still alive?
I think I got caught up into listening to your statement to such an extent that, what was the question again? And this will be the final question, and then we will say thank you and call it to a close.
Forgive me if I wasn't clear. how does this stereotype and racism and prejudice that we still somehow see today affect how us as a people interact and correlate with each other, especially in the social structures within this nation? And how is it that history keeps repeating itself over the course of time? Like, why haven't we seen some kind of change?
Well, that's, you know, there has been a lot of change, except for, just as we note with the Reconstruction to Jim Crow period, whenever there is change, there is also regression. And how do you maintain whatever progress is made is another question. But what we do see today is a society in which we are somewhat more integrated. I think, especially if you look at college campuses throughout the United States, the presence of African Americans in the classroom, on the college campuses, the addition of black faculty, administrators, as well as other ethnic groups, we begin to see a situation in which there is a possibility for true change coming about. If you look at, for example, the ways in which social media is allowing younger people to address the most pressing issues today and highlighting what the problems are and finding ways to keep the conversation going and to systematically or in an incremental way attack the institutions that are at the forefront of maintaining, you know, the traditional boundaries. I think it is towards those directions we need to look. Regardless of the ways in which, for example, the current Supreme Court is reluctant to continue the progress following the 1950s and 60s, you know, there is still, I think, the possibility for the next generation or the current generation to continue to maintain that interracial cooperation and to develop new strategies for dismantling the old, I think.
I think Iris had a question.
Where is Iris? And Iris, you have the pleasure of having the final question.
thank you. I'm going to keep it really brief, and mostly it's just a final statement of what's been said tonight, and I really do want to thank this evening for you, for Joyce, for the speakers, because the legacy of Du Bois and the legacy that spirituals and the civil rights movement have brought, it's the voice of black humanity and the affirmation of that. It's the voice of black resistance and black struggle, and I just want to say, speaking to mostly white folks in the audience, that we need to be critical of the space that we take up on stage, in classrooms, and in our communities, and critical of the ongoing injustices, and really have an eye, and because we come from a very like privileged viewpoint, and we perhaps don't see this, but we really need to have a critical eye on the ongoing injustices. And I just wanted to speak to the continued legacy of this movement for justice. It goes into the Black Lives Matter movement. It goes into the prison strike. It goes into so many things that you see today. But I really do think this is an ongoing conversation. And Joyce spoke about showing up for racial justice. And if that's something you want to talk to, you can talk to me about it. You finish. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank everyone. How about you guys? Give them a round, please. Give them a round. Thank you all for coming, and thank you for your participation, everyone. Appreciate it.